we do thank you for what Jesus has done. We thank you for his grace and his mercy and his goodness to us. Let us encourage you wherever you are. Now, why don't we just begin to pray out and say to Jesus the things that we're thankful that he's done for us. Don't let it just be me, but we just begin by praying, Father, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for a new life, a new birth. We thank you that we can be here today in freedom. We thank you that you are gracious and kind and compassionate to us. We thank you that every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights. We thank you that you have given us everything we need for life and godliness. We thank you this morning that we are here. We thank you for all of the women in the church, the mothers, the spiritual mothers, those who look after young people, those who lead us in worship, and we thank you for them. And we thank you for the young people as well. We thank you that as they go off to their children's works, we thank you that they are people who inspire us to worship with boldness, with confidence, with grace, with freedom. We thank you, we pray that you bless their time in the kids' work, in Jesus' name. Worshipping earlier, I had a picture actually of a box of matches and just striking those matches and nothing happening. You know, you strike a match and you know it doesn't light. And just this sense of maybe for some of us, we've tried to light a match a couple of times, three or four times, and nothing's happened. And we kind of say, don't we? Well, if I can guarantee that the next one's gonna light, then I'll do it. And particularly in my head, I had two thoughts that might relate to. One was praying for healing, and one was sharing your faith. And I just had this sense, maybe you've tried it before and it's just not gone very well. You know, there's not been a spark. Nothing's happened. You've tried to pray and you know, the person's not been healed, or you've tried to share your faith and it's not gone very well. And I just felt that sense of God wanting to say, you know, don't put your faith and confidence in your ability to strike the match. It's God who's going to work, God who's going to do it. And maybe for some of us, me included, we've taken a step back in our boldness with that. We've taken a step back in our boldness in praying for things to happen, and a step back in boldness for sharing the gospel with people because of that very thing, because of those matches just haven't struck, they haven't lit, they haven't come about. And I just wanted to pray maybe for us that if that resonates with anyone, can I just encourage you to stand? I'm just going to pray for us. Don't feel like you don't have to stand out of politeness, but if that resonates with you, it resonated with me. We're just going to pray that actually an increased boldness and an increased confidence in the power of the gospel. Yeah, don't be afraid, guys, if you're near people who are standing, you know, to do put a hand out towards them. Paul the Apostle, probably the boldest man I know of, he wasn't afraid to say, pray for me that I might proclaim the gospel with all boldness as I ought. And so, Jesus, we just pray this morning for an increased boldness in praying for things to happen, an increased boldness in sharing the gospel with people. And we pray, Father, that you would come in power into these situations, that as we share faith with people, people would respond and be saved, that as we pray for people, things will happen. And Father, I just pray that you would give us an increased sense of faith, that you are able to do far more than we ask or imagine. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Guys, do take a seat. Do take a seat. Brilliant. I'm just going to do our reading this morning. We're looking at a bit of a series at the minute of people who encountered the risen Jesus. And this is the story of Peter in John chapter 21. And it says in John 21, after this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, the two others of his disciples were together. And Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciple came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, and they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire in place, and fish laid out on it, and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now, none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He said to them, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, feed my sheep. He said to him a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But now you are old. You will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this to him, he said, follow me. Follow me. Guys, just a quick question for you. I was thinking about. I was wondering what your favourite flavour of crisps is. Does anyone have a favourite flavour?
Ready,
salted, cheese and onion, salt and vinegar. You said prawn cocktail. Interestingly, in our house, we buy these multi-packs of Walker's crisps. You know what I mean? The big boxes. And you can guarantee, after a week, you can go there and all you'll find is 5 packets of prawn cocktail crisps. All the good ones have gone. And all we've got left is prawn cocktail.
Thank you.
Testing 1, 2.
Yes.
Am I on? Yes.
You're on.
I'm on. Thank you again for that introduction, Tom. I knew there would be something coming up. Well, good morning. Hello, good morning. It's good to see you in church this morning. We'll put that there. As Tom said, we're in a series on encountering Jesus. And can I just say, right at the beginning, that the most important thing that could ever happen in church is not that you have fellowship and that you enjoy the worship. The most important thing is that you encounter Jesus. Anybody up for that this morning? I'd love to encounter Jesus afresh. And if that happens, then you will be transformed. Am I on? Yes. The word encounter there, it's got lots of definitions. Some say to meet someone, especially unexpectedly, a chance meeting. Or another definition, a particular kind of meeting or experience with another person. And we've already had 2 stabs at this particular subject. Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was looked at, and then Thomas. You looked at Thomas, didn't you? Yes. They were important encounters with Jesus. And today we're looking at Peter, who had several encounters with Jesus. Before we go into Peter, let's remind ourselves what will happen. We will be transformed if Jesus meets us today. Now, I know he's here all the time, and I know that he's omnipresent. But if you have a special touch from Jesus today, things will be different in your life. I love that verse in Ephesians. It says, may Christ dwell in your hearts. That means an encounter, a regular encounter with Jesus. That you may have power to comprehend what is the breadth, the length, the height, the depth of God's love. If we have an encounter with Jesus, we will be expanded in every direction. The breadth speaks of our capacity to have more of God. And we've got as much of God as we want, someone said. But God wants to enlarge us. Jabez prayed in the Old Testament, will you enlarge me? And as for anyone else, I want you to know that the preacher says, I want to be enlarged in God, even though I've been on the road for a long time. The length speaks of consistency. I want to be right there to the end. I'd like to feel that whatever mistakes I've made in the past, and I've made a few, I'd like to think that my consistency I'll be serving Jesus right to the end. The depth speaks of my intimacy, that I will draw near to Jesus. If I have an encounter with Jesus today, then I will love him more. I will be more intimate with him. The height speaks of our ascendancy, speaks of our worship. And however good our worship is, there's always higher heights that we need to attain to. So Lord, please, will you give the preacher a fresh encounter with Jesus? And all of us here today and on our Zoom meetings or whatever. So now, we're looking at Peter. I love Peter. I love Peter because he's so human, he's so ordinary, he has so many faults as I do, and yet God loved him and Jesus loved him. I'd like to just give you a couple of stories about Peter where he encountered Jesus and how he was changed as a result. Remember the first time, I don't know whether it was the first time he met with Jesus, but certainly this was a transforming occasion. He'd been fishing all night and he'd caught nothing. Now for a fisherman, that's terrible. The wife would have had a go at him by the time he got home. No fish today, what is going on? So he's washing his nets. He's maybe working with his brother Andrew, I don't know, limited company to own a fishing boat. He couldn't have been poor. He had a decent business going. And then Jesus comes along. And there's a whole crowd following Jesus. Wherever Jesus went, there was a big crowd. And so he turns to Peter and says, can I use your boat as a pulpit? He said, yeah, of course you can, Jesus. So he pushes out and sits down in the boat and preaches. And because Jesus is no man's debtor, he says, I want to pay for the use of your boat. So I want you to cast out into the deep and throw your net over the side. Peter says, I've been toiling all night, Jesus. I know how to fish. You fish at night, you don't fish. He could have had that conversation, we don't know. Certainly if you go to Israel today, you still see the same boats. They go out at night and they put a lamp over the edge of the boat, and the fish are attracted to the light. They throw the net out and they catch the fish. Fishing during the day is not what you do. But because Jesus said, he did it. And you know the story. The story is that they caught so many fish that they had to call other boats to help them with the haul of fish. In fact, the nets broke. Now, fishermen are pretty superstitious people. And Peter's looking at this and he's seeing something is not right here. Something supernatural has happened. This does not happen during the day. He realizes that this man, Jesus, was more than a man. He's seen a miracle. And I tell you what, when you're confronted with the supernatural, you don't just glibly carry on. There's something going on in your being. You have an encounter with the supernatural. And you realize there's something more to life than just, you know, food and drink and what have you. He realizes that this man, Jesus, is more than a man. And he says to him, get away from me, Jesus. I'm a sinful man. He knew that Jesus was holy. This could not have happened naturally. And so he cries out, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. You have an encounter with God. He will not necessarily judgmentally put his finger on your life, but you'll immediately know you're not what you should be. That some changes need to happen in your life. Depart from me. And then Jesus replies, follow me, Peter, and I will make you a fisher of men. And I love that, because when you follow Jesus, he always makes you into something better than you were. So that's the first encounter. It was an encounter of conviction. Second encounter, there's lots, by the way. I'm jumping over whole swathes of history over the 3 years, but let me just pick out a couple. The second encounter was an encounter of desperation. Now, Peter has followed Jesus, and he's seen all sorts of miracles, heard great sermons. And on one occasion, Jesus feeds 5,000 men plus the women and children. So there's a lot of people. And at the end of that miracle, Jesus turns to the disciples and says, I want to meet you over the other side of the lake. So get into a boat. Now it's getting nighttime. So they get into a boat and they start sailing across the Sea of Galilee. They've done that many times. But on this occasion, there's a bit of a difficult wind against them. So we find them at midnight and they're in the middle of the lake. And would you believe it, they see a ghost. They assume it's a ghost anyway. Because Jesus has now left the shore and is walking, and it's walking on the water. And it's Peter who says, that's the Lord. Jesus, if it's you, bid me come to you. And Jesus says, come. So this foolish man gets out of the boat. Gets out of the boat and starts walking on water. And as long as he kept his eyes on Jesus, he could walk on water. I don't know how far Jesus was away. But as soon as he turned his eyes off of Jesus and saw the wind and the waves, because we're told there was a storm, he starts to sink. What do you do when you're sinking? What do you do when life has just thrown everything at you? What do you do when you're depressed? What do you do when your finances are completely gone to shit? Whatever. I nearly said a word then. What do you do when life has just collapsed around you? You're sinking. Let me tell you, the best thing you can do is cry out, help! It may be a short prayer. But I'll tell you what, God is in the business of answering short prayers. So there he is, he's sinking. He says, help me, Lord. And Jesus reaches out, lifts him up and puts him in the boat. And then he says, of all things, Jesus says, O man of little faith. Has anybody apart from Peter walked on water? a man of little faith. Oh, by the way, a little aside here. When's the last time you took a step of faith? Have you struck the matches that many times and they fizzled out and you've decided you're not going to strike the match again, Tom? Or are you going to say, no, faith is spelled R-I-S-K. It's spelled risk. When is the last time you did something that was a risk? That you couldn't rely on your natural gifts and talents and all the experience you've got, you've gained over the years. You took a risk. You took out in faith. You said, no, the match may not have lit last time, but I'm going to give it a go again. I believe God's calling us to step out of the boat and take risks. So the first experience was experience of conviction. Second encounter, of course there were others, was an encounter of desperation. Is anybody here or on the video desperate enough to say, God, I need your help? And on this Mother's Day, some of us blokes are so pig-headed and proud that we are slow to cry out for God's help. The third encounter that I want to talk about happened in a place called Caesarea Philippi. I put the map up here because I've been there several times. It's right up in the north of Israel, near the base of Mount Hermon. And Jesus takes his disciples for this long walk up to Caesarea Philippi. I love this place. Been there, I don't know how many times, half a dozen at least times. Because it's the base of Mount Hermon, and there's a big cave there. I'll take a photograph of it here. It's not very clear, and if you're on the video, you probably won't see it. And then out of this cave, there is a river that just gushes out, probably nearly the width of this room here. And it's remarkable. It's such a geographical phenomena, said the word right, that in the early days of the Greek gods, they thought this is, because water was so important in Israel. And they assumed that the Greek god of nature must have been born there, the god Pan, because all this water is gushing out of nowhere. Where is it coming from? So they say that's where the god became man, Pan, the god Pan, and it was called Panias to start with. Later on, the emperor, his son Philip, took over charge of that particular area. And Philip thought to himself, I like this idea of being God. I think I'm going to get people to call me God. It was the first place that men decided that they would be called God. So here you've got this very religious place, and if you go there, there's shrines all over the place, little niches where gods were there. And Jesus takes his disciples up for this long walk up to Caesarea Philippi, and he decides there to ask them a question. This religious place, it's a beautiful place, water's still gushing out today. And he asks them, what do men say that I am, or who do men say that I am? And of course, people gave their opinions. Some say you're the prophet Isaiah, some say you're John the Baptist, risen from the dead, or whatever. They gave their opinion. But then Jesus says, who do you say that I am? And it's Peter who says, I know who you are. You're the Christ. That doesn't mean much to us English people, but to a Jewish person back then, it meant that he's the Messiah. He's the one that the whole of the Jewish nation was looking for. You're the Christ. It was a place of revelation. Jesus says, you couldn't have seen that yourself, Peter. It must have been the Holy Spirit that told you that. And as a result of that, at last now I can build my church. This was 2.5 years into the ministry of Jesus that this happened. And Jesus says, I'm going to change your name, Peter. You're called Simon at the moment, which means reed, which means you're easily swayed. I'm going to call you a rock. I'm going to call you Peter, rock. But unfortunately, Peter's going to have another encounter with Jesus that makes him realize that if you're going to become a rock, you sometimes have to reach rock bottom. Anybody reached rock bottom? Anybody ever got to the place where you thought, I can't go any lower, Lord? Well, Peter was going to have this experience, this encounter. By the way, let's just pause there and just remind ourselves that if you are not a Christian here, either on the screen or even in this room here, because you can attend church and not be a Christian, let me tell you this. This is the simple gospel message. The gospel message is that you need to recognize you're a sinner like Peter. Lord, I'm a sinner. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. You've got to recognize that you need salvation. You used the word propitiation last week in your sermon, Tom, that somebody had to pay the debt, cancel the wrath of God because of our sin. So the first step of salvation is recognizing you're a sinner. The second step is to say, God, I need your help. And again, some of us are so pig-headed and proud that maybe we're so full of ourselves that maybe I don't need help, thank you very much. I'll do it my way. I did it my way. That is the most popular song at funerals, and I've taken many funerals, and they'll play that song, I did it my way. If you want to do it your way, it'll take you to hell. Sorry. No, I'm not sorry. The Bible is clear to say you can't do it your way. You need help. You need somebody to turn away the wrath of God, the propitiation. But then, of course, Peter says, you're the Christ. In other words, you need to recognize that there's salvation in no other name except the name of Jesus. There's one mediator between God and man, and that's the man Christ Jesus. You've got to say, look, Jesus, you're the answer. If you've never done that, if you've never given your life to Jesus, recognizing you can't do it yourself, however old or young you are, recognizing that you need help, recognize that Jesus is the only way that you can have salvation, there's no reason why right now you couldn't, in the quietness of this moment, say, Jesus, please, I need your help. I have done wrong things. You don't have to close your eyes, by the way. I'll just close my eyes because I was praying, but you don't have to do that. Lord, I need your help. I'm a sinner. Please come into my life. You're the only one that can do it. You're the Christ. You're the Savior who died on a cross 2,000 years ago for me. And today is the day of salvation. Today you can know salvation from your sin by simply giving your life to the Lord Jesus. Little digression, Tom. Sorry, apologize. No, I don't apologize. Why am I keep on apologizing? Right, it's Mother's Day. So here's the little encounter that Peter had on Mother's Day. Well, it wasn't Mother's Day, but his mother-in-law was sick. They lived by the Sea of Galilee, and he'd already been following Jesus for some while. And so, Jesus, my mother-in-law, she's sick. So Jesus prays for her. She had a fever. And heals Peter's mother-in-law, so we know he's married. It's Mother's Day. And on that particular day, we're told there in Mark chapter 1, it was probably one of the busiest days Jesus had. And I want to tell you, he was busy. Everyone who was sick came. It says many demons were cast out. Can you imagine the schedule? You know, his Filofax. You wouldn't even know what Filofax was, Tom. Right? His daily routine was... Every person in the whole area wanted to touch Jesus. And yet we're told, after that busy schedule, the next day, early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Was that the occasion when the disciples crept up and after they watched Jesus pray, said, Jesus, we don't know how to pray like you do. Will you teach us how to pray? I don't know whether it was that occasion, but it was one of those early occasions when Jesus prayed after a very, very busy day. I need to challenge you as I challenge myself. The preacher challenges himself today. Am I so busy, even retired, to forget the one thing that's needful? I can get up early and go to the gym, and I do. I like to be there at 6:20 when it opens. And I'm happy to go to the gym early. Am I happy to get up early in the morning, be a great while before dawn, to pray? What's my intercession like? Have I gone a bit sort of slack in my prayer life? I'll throw it out to you. Fifth encounter that I've just mentioned now, we're now getting towards John chapter 21. Tom, we will get there, honestly. Before we get to chapter 21, you've got to look at John chapter 18. Because in John chapter 18, Jesus has now been arrested. And in the Garden of Gethsemane, Peter has chopped off the ear of the servant. And there's John and Peter following the crowd where Jesus has been taken. And before he gets to Pilate, he's taken to Annas and Caiaphas. That's the father-in-law, so you'd help me, Marla. Anyway, Annas was supposedly the high priest, but he'd been deposed by the Romans. So Caiaphas. And he's now taken to the garden of the high priest, who was supposed to give him some kind of trial. Now, we don't quite know why John was allowed into the garden, but obviously he knew somebody, so John's allowed in the garden, but Peter's left outside. And John, after a while, goes and collects Peter. He says, all right, he can come in with me. But the servant girl at the gate, the lowest job ever, the young kid, the young girl, the servant girl says, aren't you one of them? No, I'm not. All right, come on in. First denial. Then they gather around the charcoal fire because it was cold. And Peter's warming himself by the fire and he's challenged again. Aren't you one of those? He denies Jesus a second and then a third time. Interestingly, it's only in Luke's gospel, not the other three, we're looking at John today, but we're told that just after that third denial, Jesus walks in. And we're told very clearly by Luke that he looks at Peter. I think it was that look, not the cock crowing three times, that just devastated Peter. Interesting, if you're into this kind of thing, I do like it. On the one occasion that we're told that Jesus looked at Peter, it was when he first was called, when Andrew took Peter to meet Jesus. And we're told clearly that Jesus looked at Peter. Now, I want to tell you, there's not one person in this room that Jesus is not looking at. And he sees right through me. He knows what's in my heart. He knows what I've said and done this last week. He knows every detail about me. Does he look with condemnation? I doubt it. He looks with grace and mercy and love. He looks at me and says, I know the thoughts and intentions of your heart. I know the failures that you've gone through. But I still love you. Peter sees the eyes of Jesus looking. And by the way, one look, if Susan was here this morning, she could be sitting on the back there and she could give me one look and I'd know I've gone too far. Anybody, you husbands, know what I'm talking about? One look and you... one look from Jesus. So he runs out because it's devastated. He went outside and wept bitterly. Why did Peter deny? Well, there's any sorts of reasons. I think there's probably a lead up. If you're going to deny Jesus or make a mess of your spiritual life, it'll normally be a process rather than a crisis. Was it because he fell asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane? Why does the Bible have to tell us, awake, awake, O Zion? When are you going to strengthen the things that remain? How many know it's easy to fall asleep spiritually? It's easy to drift. Things didn't go wrong in the church, and so you get a bit negative or a bit critical or this or that, and you just take your foot off the accelerator. Well, Peter fell asleep. Backsliding is a process, not a crisis. He tried to do things in his own way. Remember, I'll die for you, Jesus. And so he gets his sword out and whips off the ear of the young fellow in the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus says, put your sword away. Have you moved from the spirit to the flesh? Easily done. You end up making a mess of things. And then, of course, this self-confidence that Peter has. He's a reed easily swayed in the wind. He's going to be called a rock. But he said, I'll never deny you, Jesus. You can't, you're never going to wash my feet, Jesus. Wash all the rest, but not my feet, never. Never say never. It's a dangerous word. But anyway, he ends up in that place where a little slave girl, the lowest of the low, makes him deny Jesus. So we come eventually to John 21. Is a stranger on the shore. Does anybody remember that? Stranger on the shore. Music. One or two, who wouldn't? That's a song. Ackerville. It's a stranger on the shore. And Peter's gone fishing. I'm going fishing, he says. Jesus has told him to go back to Galilee. So he's gone back home. And he's gone fishing because maybe that's what he's used to, he knows. And so he's gone fishing. And again, he's got in that situation where he's caught nothing. And this stranger on the shore says, lads, boys, it's a little phrase comes out in your version, not in the NIV. Boys, cast your net over the other side. Who's this bloke turning us out of fish? But they do it. And again, this huge catch of fish. Interestingly, the nets don't break this time. There's a lesson in there for us who lead churches. We don't want our nets to break. Then there's certain things that have got to happen to us before God can trust us with lots of fish. And that's what's happening to Peter. And Peter again realizes that man over there, this is not natural. This couldn't happen naturally. It's the Lord. So he puts his, because they fished in their underwear, so he puts his and jumps in and swims over, and Jesus is cooking breakfast. Where he got the fish from, we don't know. He's cooking breakfast over a charcoal fire. Again, it came out in your version, not in the NIV. There's only two places in the Bible where the word charcoal fire is used. It's here, where Jesus is going to confront Peter and recommission him. And three times he's going to ask him, do you love me? The only other time that the word charcoal fire is found in the New Testament is over there in the reading that we had in John 18, where Peter warmed himself and denied Jesus three times. So it's a confrontation. Now this little debate that, you know, we could have stayed all sermon on the little debate about Jesus, do you love me? Interestingly, I've mentioned that the word charcoal fire is mentioned twice. You know, Scandinavia has got 17 words for snow. Now, I'm a skier, and I know how important it is to know what type of snow the weather conditions. Mark, you'll help me. I thought there was only 5 Greek words for love, but I looked it up yesterday and found out there's a lot more, at least 9 different words for love. C.S. Lewis underline the 4 main words that we use in his book, The Four Loves, Eros, Philia, and what have you there. But there's this conversation going on with Jesus. Peter, do you love me? It's sort of like a young girl wanting to find out whether the boy is committed to her. So he says, do you love me? And the boy says, well, I'm very fond of you. And the girl's not happy with that. But yeah, but do you love me? I said, well, I'm very fond of you. And the girl says, are you just fond of me? Jesus is having this conversation with Peter. And it's so challenging to me. Do you love me, Barry? Well, I did love you when I first got saved, Lord. I'd do anything. You talk about going and witnessing. If it moved, I'd witness to it. Prayer meeting, I would be at everything. Yes, but Barry, do you love me today? Or have you lost your first love? So the conversation that Jesus has with Peter. You see, Peter has now gone to the place where he says, I can't lie to you, Jesus. You're asking me if I'm committed, do I love you? I can only say, Lord, I'm fond of you. Because he's come to himself, like Jacob. Remember Jacob wrestles with the angel? And the angel says, or God himself. And the angel said, what's your name? He knew his name. He knew it was Jacob he was wrestling with. But for Jacob's sake, what is your name? And Jacob said, yeah, Jesus, I'm Jacob. I'm the twister. I'm the liar. I'm the cheat. In other words, he'd come to himself. He'd come to a realization that you can't go forward unless you recognize who you are. Recognize that you need God's help. And here, Peter says, I can't lie to you anymore, Jesus. I'm still the reed. I'm still the Simon. We have this lovely little phrase. Peter, same that he said 3 years earlier, follow me. Recommissioned, restored, back to a place despite the failure. There isn't one person in this room that hasn't failed. There isn't one person in this room that doesn't need an encounter with Jesus. There isn't one person in this room whose heart hasn't grown cold sometimes and the love has diminished. Preacher included. The question says, Barry, do you love me? If we'd have had communion this morning, and we're not, but if we'd have had communion, I would have concluded with the last slide. Let a man examine, or woman examine himself. So before you commit communion, you should look at yourself before you take the bread and the wine. First, I need to ask you, and I'll ask myself, are you saved? Be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. Do you know you love Jesus? You're saved. Your sins are forgiven. But even if you are saved today, has there ever been a time when you love Jesus more than you love him today? Has your love grown dim, Barry? How far have you come since you were first saved? Or do you need the wake-up call? Callum. Oh, no, no, sorry, you don't need to. I'm just saying, I'm using. There was a little parable that Callum did last week. He gave that announcement last week about praying for the sick. He was over here. I won't move out of the way because of the, he was over here. And while he was saying, come to Jesus to receive prayer. Is your son Ezekiel? Yeah. While he was standing, come to Jesus and receive prayer. Ezekiel, over here, unashamed that there were people looking at him, totally free of anything that would stop him, running to his dad, while he was announcing, ran up to Callum. That's how you run to Jesus. You don't worry about what people are looking at. This Jesus says, do you love me? Not condemning you, wanting to restore you, wanting to heal you, wanting you to strike the match again. Step out in faith. Thank you, Tom.
Wonderful. Thank you, Barry. I quite like prawn cocktail crisps, so it's a compliment, really. I just thought it would be fitting for us to, before Diane, are you happy to lead us in worship? As Diane comes up, I just wanted to read you a few words from Peter's letter that I think might be really fitting. It says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now, for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. I just love that phrase that he has where he says, now, if necessary, though you are tested by various trials. I wonder if there are any trials that you're facing, maybe we could bring to Jesus in this next time. Are you happy to come and lead us? If you do feel like you have anything that you would like someone to pray for, Callum and one or two others will be over here at the end of the worship time. Do come and they will be more than happy to pray for you. Guys, bless you.
Let's just reflect and where our faith rests, the rock, the cornerstone.
Christ our Lord, come.
things that we're praying for as a church is to see people being saved and set free by Jesus. And we pray now, Lord, that we trust this is true, that you are one who makes a way, the one who works miracles, the one who keeps promises. We pray this morning that there would be men and women over the town of Chesterfield who are coming to put their faith and their confidence and trust in Jesus. We pray that every faithful, gospel-preaching, Bible-believing church in Chesterfield would be reaching out in the power of Jesus to see people being saved. And we pray for that here. We long to see people coming to know Jesus and be set free by Jesus. And I just pray, Father, you would use the people in this room this week. Would you put us into situations where we can pray, where we can share our faith, where we can step out of the boat and have faith and confidence in you. We trust, Jesus, that you are able, that you are willing to make a way. And we pray this morning that people would be saved by the power of Jesus. We pray that people would encounter the risen, reigning, ruling Lord of the universe. And we pray, Father, that you would use us as your conduits, Father, that you would send us out on mission, and that you would work a wonderful, powerful act of grace in people's lives, in Jesus' name.